was out there offshore, it was Christmas time. So I was doing a lot of reading around the Christmas story. And what happened was there was a couple of guys offshore that came to me and they wanted to do a Christmas service. And these were two new guys that had never done it with me before. I had been doing Bible studies for a little while. And so it was really interesting, this one in particular, just the fact that he was even interested. It really blew me away. So it was the same day I had to get something together. So I did the best I could, and it really came together. I believe God gave me something for them that day, and I'm just kind of taking some of what I had studied when I was out there reading the Christmas story and everything. And this has everything to do with our faith. This has everything to do with our Christian walk. It has everything to do with our salvation, with our sanctification. This message is not just about, you know, a baby coming, you know, from heaven to earth, which it is very important. And I know there's a lot of different ideas about Christmas. There's a lot of different, Matt shared a lot of his thoughts and his beliefs about it. And I have some strong beliefs about it too. And my biggest one is Santa Claus just really, you know, just gets under, the whole idea of Santa Claus really gets under my skin. It just really rubs me the wrong way. And everything else that follows and goes with that, or, you know, is anything remotely like that, you know, I guess you could, I don't know. Anyway, whatever. But I want to start and just do some scripture reading. It's not a whole lot. I know the last time that I preached, there was a lot of scripture reading. It won't be quite that much. But I know it's really important, and you hear it a lot from this church, how important it is to have context, you know, whenever we do read something. Because for so long in America, we've heard so many messages. So many messages have been preached. There's probably been hundreds or thousands, maybe more than that, that have been preached. And how many of them, I don't know. I mean, how many of them were really preached out of context? The context of God's Word. What was His original intent? And I realized that you can go into the original intent of God's Word and you can bring it down to where we are today and have some real life application. And it's really important for us to find that. But to take something and make it, you know, into something it's not, to twist it off. God's not obligated to stand behind a message.
That's good.
To send His Spirit and move on behalf of a message that is preached completely and totally out of context.
Amen.
And the fact of the matter is, not only is He not obligated, but He won't.
Amen.
He's not going to do it. So then there comes a lot of deception. Some of the worst kinds of deception comes from the preaching and the teaching of God's Word, when it's preached wrong, when it's preached out of context. That's a mouthful to say that, so now I'm praying, Lord God, please let me stay in context. I believe that I will be. But anyway, we're going to start, you know, there's more than one account of the Christmas story, and it shows different angles. We're going to read from Matthew chapter 1, verse 18. That's going to be the passage that we're going to mostly be focused on. And we'll do just a little bit of reading from Matthew 1:18. And I'm going to try and go slow enough for Manuel there. There's going to come a part in this message where you might as well just hang it up. It's not going to happen, you know what I'm saying? I'm going to fly through some scripture. But we're going to go all the way to chapter 2, verse 12. And starting in verse 18 of Matthew chapter 1. It says, "Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise. When as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man, and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privily. But while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Now all this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. Then Joseph, being raised from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and took unto him his wife, and knew her not till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, Where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east, and are come to worship him. When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. And they said unto him, In Bethlehem of Judea. For thus it is written by the prophet, And thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah. For out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel. Then Herod, when he had privily called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, Go and search diligently for the young child. And when you have found him, bring me word again that I may come and worship him also. When they had heard the king, they departed. And lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned of God in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed into their own country another way. The wise men, the first point that I want to make tonight, Christopher. The wise men were not afraid to ask the present day king where to find the real king. Do you realize, I don't know about y'all, I mean, how many times have we heard this part of the story? How many times have we read over this story? I don't know why. I mean, it's so obvious. It's like, are you kidding me? These guys went to the king, the present day king, and said, hey, where is the king? Where is he at? We want to find him. And not only did they say that, I mean, slap him one side of the face and then just bring it back in the next stroke and slap the other side of the face. Because when we find him, what we came to do is to worship him. And I don't know if they had the gifts on them when they went in there. Maybe they did, maybe they didn't. Maybe they were strapped to their camel or whatever it is, however they were traveling. But they brought some really nice gifts to give him. And just the insult, you know, and of doing such a thing. And if you know anything about this Herod, this was Herod the Great. That was his title, what they called him. And there's different theories on what the reason is they called him Herod the Great. And I don't really want to talk about that so much. But there was a Herod dynasty. There was a dynasty of Herods. And I don't know if you know this, but Herod was actually the very first Jewish king that was actually not of the true, genuine Jewish lineage. He was appointed by Caesar, by Augustus Caesar. He was the first one. And so by him taking that position, there were a lot of self-imposed threats. And maybe, you know, there were actual threats that were very real. But in his mind and in his heart, he was really, really feeling at that time real threat. Because he knew he was not the real thing. He wasn't by lineage, by bloodline. And then now these wise men come up and they're looking for the real king of the Jews. And I'm throwing real in there. I know it doesn't actually say that they said it like that. But I mean, that's what I'm reading in there. And so, man appointed king of the Jews, Herod. He's the man appointed king. Augustus Caesar appointed him. And then here comes wise men who are looking for the God-appointed king of the Jews. There was a difference in these two kingdoms. One was of an earthly kingdom. The other one was of a heavenly kingdom. One was of a kingdom that was surely going to come to an end, and very soon it would come to an end. That Herod dynasty didn't last very long. There were 10 marriages that his father had. And then there was like 15 children. And out of the 15 children, there was like four of them who actually were made rulers over little pieces of land. And of course, Herod, you know, the Great, he had the largest piece. He was the king. And so the whole time through his whole rule and reign, according to Josephus, the historian, and even Eusebius, who was a latter historian who came along, they all agreed that he really was really scared. The way that he acted, the way that he functioned, the things that he did, it was very obvious. And so the difference between these two kingdoms, an earthly kingdom and a heavenly kingdom, was obviously one was a kingdom of dead faith. One was a kingdom where it was rooted and it was grounded in lies and deception. He didn't deserve that position. There was no way he could maintain that position. There was no way that he could ever hold it for very long. And he didn't. And then versus the other kingdom, which was the kingdom of living faith. It was a kingdom that was grounded in the living truth. The baby was about to be born. Jesus was about to enter this world. God the Father had sent His Son for a specific purpose. And whether we make a big deal out of celebrating the birth of Christ or not, I really honestly don't think that is a big deal, because scripturally speaking, I don't see anywhere where we're commanded or instructed. We see where the shepherds worshipped Him. It was a celebration of His birth, right? I mean, that's a celebration. We see the wise men, how they worshipped, and that was a celebration of His birth. But obviously, you know, what we believe here is that the biggest emphasis is on His death and His resurrection and that celebration. Because that's what really gives us the grace. Had Jesus come and never died and rose from the dead, we wouldn't be able to celebrate salvation. We wouldn't be partakers. Amen. And we wouldn't be children of God. We wouldn't be those Gentiles that have been grafted into the vine as Jews. Right. And so with just the birth of Christ, but without the death and the resurrection of Christ, it's incomplete. The gift was not a full, complete gift. And so it was absolutely necessary for it to go down that way. And so that's the difference between the two kingdoms. Now, a little bit more about Herod the Great and his family and where he came from. Again, I'm not going to get that deep, but just kind of graze over it briefly. Matt, you may know a little bit better how to pronounce this. Idumea, it's like the property south of...
Idumea,
okay, there you go.
Edom and Esau.
Right, came from Edom and Esau. That his father came from that tribe, from that line, from the Edomites. And so I know you hear it a lot up here, you know, the Edomites come from Esau. So, but what happened was the Herod family, they converted to Judaism. So originally they weren't believers, they didn't believe in that. What was the reason, what was the motivation, I don't know. You know, maybe history would shed a little light about that. But whatever the case, he was a Jew, not a Jew. He was a Jew, not really a real, you know, in the heart of the matter, he was not the real thing. He was not all about that. He brought in priests. This caused absolute utter chaos and confusion in the kingdom of you know, what they could call Judah or Israel at that time, was that not just that the king, he being the king, was not of the proper lineage in the line, but also he brought in a priest that was not of the proper lineage in line. And that was a big, huge deal to the Israelites, to the Jews. Don't be coming up in here messing with the lineage of the doggone priest. Because that goes back to where Abraham, that goes all the way back to the beginning, where Moses, God gave it to Moses, and it was established. This is the order by Jehovah God. The king thing was not such a thing that God really, you know, God didn't really want them to have a king per se. So that wasn't a big deal. And the Jews knew, and they were raised that way, and they were taught that way to know that, hey, this is the divine order of God, is the priestly order, the priestly lineage. And it came from Aaron's tribe, it came from the tribe of Levi, and that was the lineage that it had to come up from. So this guy was causing a lot of problems. He did do a little bit to gain some favor with the Jews, but when it came down to it, he really messed that relationship up with them. And so being raised a Jew and knowing how things were supposed to be done, he still went forward with this, and he still did it. He went so far, he felt so threatened and he felt so insecure, Herod the Great, in who he was and in his position, that this guy, after he became king, he knew he was not of noble origin, right? He wasn't of that proper line. So they kept records. If you know anything about the Jews and the way things were, they had very strong oral traditions. That was probably the strongest of all, because you could take all the copies, all the writings, and destroy them, but they were taught orally by memory to know what the lineages were. They were taught to know the scriptures. Many of them could memorize the whole Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible. It was just part of their culture. It was ingrained in them. And so what he did was he took the family records of succession and he destroyed them by fire. Foolishly. Because the oral tradition still stood, and eventually it got in the Bible, right? Matthew, Mark, you know, in the Gospels. They show these lineages. They show how it came, how it was supposed to come down. And so that was all in a feeble attempt to try to protect himself, to protect his rule as king. The wise men sought boldly with confidence in the face of a jealous and an angry and an earthly king, in spite of the risks involved. The wise men didn't care so much about what risk might be involved. The Bible says here that they came from the east. It's not very specific. That's about as much information as you can really get from Scripture. And then there's other ideas and other studies that are alluding to the idea that it's possible that these wise men, that they may have come from Babylon because of Daniel. According to Scripture, there's no indication that Daniel ever left Babylon. Of course, we know eventually they were no longer held captive there. But Daniel and his story with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego being on the team with the wise men that were there in that kingdom, in that empire, they were mixed in with sorcerers, with magicians, with counselors, advisors. You know, it was quite an interesting mix. But then here comes Daniel, Shadrach, and Meshach, and Abednego, who had the Spirit of God operating and functioning through them. And so when you look up the words of what wise men were back there in Babylon, it's the same. It has the same idea, the same connotation. They were magi. It can have different applications, but so you know, the idea the wise men came from the east. The geography works out. If you look at it, I mean, straight east over is Babylon, the old Babylon Empire around Saudi Arabia and Iraq, around that area. So you know, these are some interesting ideas and could very well be the case. So to make this point, I said all that, is that these wise men, there's a slim possibility they may have been Jewish in their, you know, their line because of Daniel, because of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Why are magi, why are magicians and sorcerers, why are they going to come and travel intently, you know, really, really wanting to find the baby? Wanting to follow this star and to find this baby who is to be the Christ, the anointed one, the Messiah. Why would some heathens want to do that? Why would they ever be interested in any such thing? So, you know, it raises some possibilities. Just throwing that out there. And so the fact that they were able to go boldly just shows that they were being led by the Holy Spirit. The only thing that could lead someone to do something so risky and so foolish by earthly terms and so crazy, it would be the Holy Spirit, because they were protected, because they were on a track, and that track was the leading of the Holy Spirit. And so they were able to do what they did and have the confidence and have the peace to know that they were protected and that they were going to be okay. But their purpose was to give honor and to worship him. That was the whole purpose of their going. And so they were intent on finding the truth at any cost. It didn't matter if it meant confronting a lie. And that's exactly what they did. It may have been indirectly, but they went to the king and they said, "We want to know, do you know where the real king is? Do you know where the king is?" And so they confronted the lie right then and there. And what does he do? He's in an uproar. He was disturbed. He was troubled, the Bible says there that we read. And it wasn't just him. The rest of Judah was disturbed. They were all in an uproar about this. And so it was becoming a problem. And Herod didn't understand the spiritual nature of Christ's kingdom. He had no idea. If he understood the nature of Christ's kingdom, he wouldn't be worried about this little baby, like a little baby is going to come and dethrone him. How in the world is that going to happen? You know, while he's still a baby, he's got to have time to grow up and get some maturity. You know, and when you start to look at what he did and how he behaved and how ridiculous it was, it's a perfect picture of how the world responds when they see just a little bit of truth, when they see just a little bit of light. It might be how an atheist might respond. It might be how a sinner who's not ready to surrender might respond.
Amen.
They'll diligently go to work hard to fight against it and cause nothing but absolute confusion and chaos in their own life. Not to mention all the chaos and confusion that he caused in the world that was around him, but in his own life. And so as we go along, you'll see more of that confusion and what he did. He eventually slaughtered the male babies. We know that from Scripture. Of course, later on in the story, right after the wise men went and they worshipped him and they went home a different way, and he realized they weren't coming back, and he realized that he had been deceived by them, that they never were going to come back. Then he decides to kill all the male children. If it had stopped there, I mean, that was bad enough, right? I mean, that's pretty intense. That's insane. It didn't stop there. Is it possible it could get more insane? I'll let you decide, because according to Josephus and Eusebius, it didn't stop there. He ended up killing his own wife, Mary Ann. And then after he kills his wife, the two sons, it takes them a little time, and then they start to realize he killed Mom. And so then Herod really gets scared and gets fearful, and he's tripping. And so he orders to have them put to death. So he has his own children, his own boys, put to death. All because he was worried about them. He felt threatened. He was insecure. He felt threatened in his throne and in that kingdom. His two sons were Alexander and Aristobulus. And so after that happened, after he killed his wife, according to church history, and after he had his two sons put to death, there was a saying that came up in Judah, and they said, "It is better to be Herod's pig than to be one of his sons." You were a whole lot safer being a pig in his kingdom. So the Herod dynasty included Herod Archelaus, was one of his brothers, Herod Philip, Herod Antipas, Herod Agrippa I. These were all brothers of his. And then there was Herod Agrippa II, which was Agrippa I. It was his son. And after Herod Agrippa II ruled, that was it. That was the end of the dynasty. Look how short-lived that was. It didn't go very long. And so my second point, Christopher, head knowledge isn't enough. Head knowledge will never, ever be enough for us to be able to truly accept Jesus, to truly accept who he is and what he came to do when he came here. The chief priests were able to quote word for word the scriptures about where Jesus, the baby, was supposed to be born. They could quote it. They knew it by heart. According to scripture, he asked them, he didn't ask them, he demanded of them, where is the baby, where is the Messiah supposed to be born? And I mean, they spit it out like it was nothing. I'm telling you, they knew the scripture. They had a head knowledge. That was in Matthew 2, 5 through 6, verses 5 through 6. So it says he demanded to know where. But look at what the wise men asked. They didn't demand, they just said. The scripture says they asked, saying, where is the baby supposed to be born? Where is Jesus supposed to be born? And then he's demanding, he's freaking out. He's like, oh yeah, we got to find out. We need to know, where is this baby going to be born? Or was it born? Or, not really sure what, but wanting to know. He's panicking over a baby. How kingdom of men who are in darkness act. Just look at it. And that's what the darkness will do. And all it takes from us, even as believers, as Christians, is just to let a little bit of that darkness in. The first message that I preached over here was a message about light and darkness. And all it takes is just a little bit of darkness that we allow in, and we put our faith in it. It may drive us to fear and not believing. And it will absolutely, it'll destroy a Christian. It can destroy anyone. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter who you are or what your status is. The further a person gets from God's grace, the more diligent and reckless they become. And that's what Herod did. He just got more and more reckless as time went on. The chief priests were book smart. They were head smart. They had it here. But the wise men, they were heart smart. And the difference between being head smart and heart smart will give you two totally different results. The same priest in Luke chapter 22, verses 67 through 70. I'll wait for you, Manuel, on that one. Luke chapter 22, verses 67 through 70. They were questioning, are you the Christ? They were talking to Jesus, full-grown man, according to history and according to the dates and the timelines, approximately 33 years old, something like that, somewhere thereabout, because this is right before he was going to go get crucified. And they're questioning him, and they're asking him, are you the Christ? Are you the Son of God? I mean, just really digging in and grilling him. And finally, he tells them, yeah. Yeah, that's exactly who I am. I am the Christ. I am the Son of God. That head knowledge that they had that day, when Herod asked them where he was going to be born, it wasn't enough. It's never enough just to have head knowledge. And that was the big difference. That was the big, huge, massive difference between the wise men and Herod. The wise men, for all we know, they may have never accepted Jehovah God yet. They may not. I mean, you know, I threw out the theory, and it's just a theory, the idea that maybe they were, you know, coming from a Babylonian empire, the kingdom over there, and maybe they were somehow descendants of Daniel, or Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And that's all theory, but had they ever really received Jehovah God? Had they truly received Him and taken on His ways and decided to live and serve Him? It didn't really matter at this point because they were seeking Jesus. They were seeking Him and they found Him. And that's the difference between head knowledge and heart knowledge. That's the difference between head smarts and heart smarts. Head smarts comes with puffed up pride and ends in eternal death. Heart smarts comes with revelation of who Jesus is, and it ends up in eternal life. Amen. Head smarts will lead you into an absolute eternal crash. It'll lead you into an earthly crash. You won't make it very far. You have peace of mind at the moment while things are going well. All you have to do is just keep breathing and let that heart keep beating because your day is coming. You might be having a good hair day today. Those who are, point number three, Chris, those who are truly wise bring their best to God. Those who are truly, truly wise, they always, always, when you come to God, you always bring your best. And that's one of the reasons that I see them as truly wise men. In Matthew chapter 2, verse 11, it talks about all the gifts that they brought. The fact of the matter is, the first gift that was given in this story was Jesus. Jesus was God, the Father's gift to us. Amen. And He had already given the, I guess you could say, the first half of that installment, because the real fulfillment of the gifts would be when He would die and raise from the dead. Jesus was God's most valuable gift to us. God had already sent many gifts before. He had sent Moses to deliver the children of Israel. He had sent Joseph, not just to deliver the children of Israel, but to deliver the whole world from famine. God had sent Noah to deliver his own family from the flood. God had sent Abraham to start his own Jewish race, his own people. These were all gifts that God had already sent, but this gift was a very different gift. And I believe everyone here understands how important and how valuable that gift is. But the fact of the matter is, so many times the story is also looked at in the wrong way concerning the wise men. You know, it's pretty much, you could say that it's concluded that there were three wise men, and that's not necessarily true. And there's actually a lot of ideas out there that definitely could point the other way, that there's had to be more than three, but I'm not saying that. But the fact of the matter is, they presented four gifts. And that's another thing. There's a lot of focus on three gifts, but there were four gifts that they presented. And the most important gift that the wise men actually presented was their worship. And the thing is, when you worship God and you worship Him in spirit, you worship Him in truth, and you give Him true, genuine worship, you've already given Him your heart. Mm-hmm. And that's the best gift that anyone can give to God, is to give them His heart or her heart, to give Him their service, to give Him their labor. Mm-hmm. And so, four in all, the most important gift that they gave that first. I thought that was very appropriate, the way the scripture unfolded the story and showed that. Now, it was appropriate that the wise men did that. They, you know, it makes me wonder, what were they discussing while they were traveling, following the star, you know? According to the idea of them being magi, being wise men, they were most likely either astrologers or astronomers or however you want to look at that. They knew about stars. It was definitely something. When Herod is asking all these questions, the star was in the sky. I mean, come on, it was visible. And he had never noticed. And his no one else seemed to have noticed in the story. You know, it certainly didn't come out that anybody else noticed. So, in my mind, it just gives me the idea that these truly were guys that understood the stars. They understood that science up to the point that you could at that time. And of course, you know, the Holy Spirit led them to see that star. So their gifts were being presented for and all. They gave the first was their worship, giving them their hearts. That being the first gift, that's the reason it was the first one that they gave. But interesting is that in verse 11 there, chapter 2 in Matthew, when they worshiped, Mary was there, y'all. Mary was there. She's in that scene. They didn't worship Mary. It says they worshiped him. And I'm going to tell you what. We need to really make a big deal out of that, because there's a lot of misconceptions about Mary. There's a lot of misunderstandings about Mary. And the fact of the matter is, if Mary was that great and if Mary was that important from that standpoint, I believe they would have fell down and just worshipped her right there with her if it was necessary in any fashion or form now. But they worshipped him. They gave the greatest gift of all to the one who deserved it the most. They worshiped Christ and they worshiped him alone. There was no Mary worship there. The indication that they had already given their hearts to him, they knew that he was Emmanuel. He was God with us. They understood that. If they didn't have the revelation while they were following the star, which it kind of makes me wonder, maybe they did. They were following the doggone star. There's ideas also based on scripture, actually. When he inquired, Herod the Great, he inquired of the wise men, what time did the star appear? And so he's trying to do the math, like, okay, what time did the star appear? So how old would this child be? And so look at what age he actually kills, you know, the children, from the ages of 2 years and younger. So did he go a little higher up to two? You know, I don't know. You know, the fact of the matter is the wise men were not there at the same time the shepherds were, okay? When the shepherds were there, he was just a brand new, fresh baby that had just been born. Jesus was older. How much older? There's a lot of ideas about that too. Jessica's got an interesting video about that, and it uses not astrology, but astronomy, the study of the stars, which I don't know how everybody feels about that, but the fact that we have a watch on our hands or in our phones and we follow that, that's based on astronomy, okay? It's a perfect science that is very precise, that you can count on. So, you know, there's ways to go study the movement of the stars and what has actually happened in the past. And it can be precise. So there's some different ideas about that too. So how insignificant any of these other gifts that they presented to him were without the first giving of the gift of worship. Had they not given that first gift, the other three would have really not meant a whole lot. Now Joseph and Mary probably wouldn't have looked at it that way because they were poor. Just knowing where they lived, where they came from, they were of a poor descent, and the gold, the frankincense, the myrrh, it was a value. They were going to need it to pay taxes. They were going to need it for travels. They were going to need it for food. They were going to need it for some different things. But, and I believe Matt has, I don't know, someone had told me that you had covered some of this stuff that I'm about to go into, but the gifts were tokens of the four gifts. The four gifts were, number one, the gift of worship was a token of his lordship. God is to be worshipped. He is Lord, right? Mm-hmm. And that's what that token of worship was for. A token of his kingship, the gold, right, represents kingship. Gold goes to the king. And then the frankincense, of course, a token of his priesthood, that he was the high priest, as Hebrews goes into great depth talking about the priesthood of Jesus, how he is our high priest. We can go and we can make our confession known to him. We can confess our sins before Jesus, and he is able to be the priest. He's able to be our Savior. He is the sacrifice. He is the Lamb. He covers it all. And so the myrrh would be a token of him being our Savior and our Redeemer, because myrrh, of course, was something they would use in embalming, which actually was used on the body of Jesus. Nicodemus brought myrrh in John chapter 19, verse 39. John 19:39, when Nicodemus was there with the handling of Jesus' body, they actually used myrrh. So it was common that it was used for the embalming of bodies. And so here we can see a beautiful picture that it's just amazing. You know, I really love this. I love this part, the four gifts, how they recognize the lordship, the kingship, the priesthood, and the redeeming faculties of Christ, him being our Savior. They were acknowledging it. Whether they realized it or not, they did. And when the wise men and women, this is point number four, when wise men and women have a real encounter with Jesus, they will leave him another way. They're not going to leave the same. Amen. And in the scripture, in verse 12 of chapter 2, it says they went home another way. Now, we know the literal context of that, right? I'm not trying to make it something it's not. But I think we would all agree that when you come to Jesus and you come to worship him, and if you would do something like what these guys did, which looked to me like something that was quite authentic and very knee-jerk reactive. When they saw him, they fell. They fell down. And when you look up the Greek on that, they literally fell down. It could take on different connotations. They may have been prostrate. They may have kissed him. You know, it's different forms of worship. In the manner in which they fell before him. But the fact of the matter is, when you leave him, you cannot leave the same. You have to be different. You have to be changed. There's no doubt about this. I wanted to talk just briefly about a guy that I have a lot of respect for in our American history. And I know there's a lot of different ideas about American history. And this is not about a debate, trust me. But one thing that we do have is we do have Noah Webster's 1828 version of his dictionary. He's the first notable American to actually create an American dictionary. And one of the things that he was very passionate about, how passionate he was about God and everything, there is writings and things in there talking about him having a conversion. There was a revival meeting that his children, his two daughters went to, and they got touched by God, and they persuaded him and his mom to go, and they went, and supposedly there was a conversion that took place for him. But whatever the case, Noah Webster was a revolutionary soldier. He was a judge, he was a legislator, he's got a long, long list, long resume, an American lexicographer. I bet you could say it. Anyway, that's the ones that put dictionaries together. Lexicographer, textbook pioneer. He was an English language spelling reformer. Thank God for that. That's one of the things I thank God for the most, that we don't talk like the English and we don't spell words like the English. It just makes so much sense to me. But anyway, of course, you know, I was raised in it. Founder and creator of Webster's Dictionary. We're not talking about the Merriam Webster Dictionary. This is something very different. This is something. He was the editor, and he was an editor and an author also. Webster's name became synonymous with dictionary. Now, why in the world am I making a big deal about Noah Webster? Well, it's because when you start looking up some words in his dictionary, and if you're interested, you can go, there's an app online. Not an app, I'm sorry, it's just a website. And it's actually Webster's Dictionary 1828.com. You can go there, you can save it. Anytime you want to look up a word, you just want to see what kind of scriptures are going to be connected to that word. This dude, I'm telling you, he might have been a deist, Sean. I don't know. I really honestly don't know. And I'm not going to, you know, like I said, we're not here to debate that. But this guy had a passion for God's word, because just about every single word in his dictionary that I've ever looked up has got some kind of connection, some kind of connotation connected to scripture. Like, he puts the scripture as an example. in his dictionary. Yeah, under the word, under that passage. It's really, really interesting. He has so much of my respect. I just think it's so cool. So when wise men and wise women have a real encounter with Jesus, I said that they're going to leave him another way. They're going to go home another way. And so the word way, I looked up the word way and I just wanted to see. He's got a lot of different entries on that. It's the length of space as a great way, a little way, course, direction of motion or travel. What way did he take? Which way shall I go? Keep in the way of truth and knowledge. Mark what way I make. Passage. Room for passing. Make way for the jury. Tendency to any meaning or act. And it goes on, and then down further. It's like the guy just can't help himself. He can only go so long, can only go so far, and he's like, we got to get some scripture up in here. Her ways are ways of pleasantness, and all her paths are peace. And then he just puts it, Proverbs 3:23. All flesh had corrupted his way. Puts it right down there, Genesis 6:12. And then he just kind of mixes it all in there together. And so I'm saying that to make it clear that the word way here, although it had a literal meaning in that particular passage of scripture, I really want to hit this hard. I want to bring it home, you know. Hodos is the Greek word for way there. Hodos. And so, of course, it can take literal meaning, and then it's going to take metaphorical meaning. And so I want to really hit home the metaphorical meaning. Course of conduct, way of thinking, the way that you feel, the way that you decide. It affects the course in which you decide on things, the choices that you make in your life. There are lots of scriptural examples. John the Baptist in Matthew. Don't even try, man. Don't even try. Matthew 3:3. Prepare you the way of the Lord. Jesus said, enter you in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. And many there be which go in thereat, because straight is the gate and narrow is the way that leads to life. And few there be that find it. Matthew 7:13-14. Matthew 21:32, Jesus said, for John came unto you in the way of righteousness, and you believed him not, but the publicans and the harlots believed him. And you, when you had seen it, repented not afterward that you might believe him. In Matthew 22:16, the Herodians, these were some of the group that actually followed after Herod the Great. He had a following. They said, Master, we know that thou art true and teachest the way of God in truth. Neither carest thou for any man, for thou regardest not the person of men. In the book of Luke, chapter 179, Luke himself said, to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. Luke 20:21. Luke said it again. He said it another way. And they asked him, saying, Master, we know that thou sayest and teachest rightly. Neither acceptest thou the person of any, but teachest the way of God truly. And Jesus said in John 14:4-7, and where I go, you know, and the way you know. Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come unto the Father but by me. If you had known me, you should have known my Father also, and from henceforth you know him and have seen him. In Acts 2:28, Peter was quoting David in his sermon that he gave that day. He said, thou hast made known to me the ways of life. Thou shalt make me full of joy with thy countenance. Saul, whose name would eventually become Paul, said in Acts 9:1-2, and Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest and desired of him letters to Damascus to the synagogues, that if he found any of this way, whether they were men or women, he might bring them bound unto Jerusalem. In Acts 13:10, Paul said, O fool of all subtlety and all mischief, thou child of the devil, thou enemy of all righteousness, wilt thou not cease to pervert the right ways of the Lord? Barnabas and Paul said in Acts 14:16, who in times past suffered all nations to walk in their own ways. So there are many applications and many uses of that same word metaphorically. There is a course, and there is a way of conduct, and there is a way in which we conduct our life, and it shows whether we have or have not been impacted by the cross of Jesus. It shows whether we truly have accepted Him and whether we truly have changed. And don't be discouraged if you're looking inside your heart and you're looking inside your life and you see that there's a lot of things that still have not changed. I've heard it put like this before. It's like a tree in the fall as it's entering into the fall. And the new life that's coming from the roots, it's drawing from the ground and it comes up the trunk of that tree. And there's brown leaves that are hanging on that tree. The life goes all the way out the branches, goes to the stems right where the leaves are hanging. Until that new life hits the brown leaves, they're not going to fall. You've got to continue to let the Holy Spirit fill you, let the message of the cross infiltrate your mind, and what's going to happen is in due time,
amen,
those brown leaves, whatever those are in your life, they're going to fall off.
That's good.
King Herod, point number five. King Herod notably destroyed new birth, while King Jesus, in his primary purpose, creates new birth. There was a really, really big difference, big contrast there. He decided to destroy all those male children, trying to destroy the one whose purpose was to give us new life and new birth. God's work will always, always, always have to be done God's way. 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ Jesus, he is a new creature. Old things have passed away, and behold, all things have become new. It's got to be done God's way. The only way that those brown leaves are ever going to fall off, the only way that those brown leaves are ever going to go away, is if it's done God's way.
Amen.
Those who are in Christ, those are the ones who become new creatures. If we're not in Christ, if you're not in Him, if you're not plugging into Him, it might be an indication if you have absolutely no desire for God's Word. It might be an indication that you're not in Him. We know we don't put too much emphasis on works, and we can. But I'm going to tell you what, your works tell you something about your heart. They tell you something about what's going on the inside of you. Be honest and be real with yourself. I do it on a regular basis. There's a story about Charles Spurgeon. And I read something. This story is one that I read a long time ago, actually. And this had a huge impact on my life. The story about his conversion. I don't know how many of you, is there anybody that remembers the story about that? Charles Spurgeon, how he came to Christ. It's powerful. And I'm going to tell you something about Charles Spurgeon. Something that they say about him is that he was raised in the church. He was raised, you know, all around it, and he saw it, he heard the scripture, sang the songs, but he never had a true conversion until this day, this story that I'm going to read you. And he was a good person. He was not a bad person. And that was a big part of his struggle. Like, why would he even need to come to Christ? Why would he even need to have some conversion, born-again experience like they were talking about? Everyone's making this big fuss about it. He was a good kid, you hear me? He was a boy that grew up in a good home. He was good. There was nothing inherently bad about him. But he still needed a true encounter with Christ. He needed to be changed. He needed, like the wise men, to fall down before Christ, to fall down before the true anointed one, the true Jesus, the true Messiah, and receive Him. It's important that we understand that. It's important that we understand that just being a good person, it's not enough.
Amen.
It's not enough. So the story of Spurgeon's conversion is widely known. And it may well be repeated. It says, it goes like this, and this is him telling the story himself. I sometimes think I might have been in darkness and despair until now. Oh, I'm sorry. I hate to mess up a good story. We just started the story and I messed it up already. But there's another thing that I really feel like I need to say before we start reading through this story is that this story is a beautiful picture of how when we talk about keeping your faith in the cross of Christ, keeping it in Christ and what He did, This story is a great painting, picture of how to do that. So if you're still confused about sanctification, you know you're saved, you know that you've accepted Christ, but you're still struggling with, okay, so what is that all about? You know, I still have to keep my faith in the cross, keep my faith in Christ. This story, it helps me, okay? So maybe it'll help you. So he says, I sometimes think I might have been in darkness and despair until now. And it had it not been for the goodness of God in sending a snowstorm one Sunday morning. While I was going to a certain place of worship, I turned down a side street and came to a little primitive Methodist church. In that chapel, there may have been a dozen or 15 people. I had heard of the primitive Methodists, how they sang so loudly and they made people's heads ache. But that did not matter to me. I wanted to know how I might be saved. The minister did not come that morning. He was snowed up, I suppose. At last, a very thin-looking man, a shoemaker or tailor, or something of that sort, went up into the pulpit to preach. Now it is well that preachers be instructed. But this man was really stupid. He was obliged to stick to his text for the simple reason that he had little else to say. The text was, "Look unto me, and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth." Isaiah 45:22. He did not even pronounce the words rightly, but that did not matter. There was, I thought, a glimmer of hope for me in that text. The preacher began thus. This is a very simple text indeed. It says, look. Now looking don't take a deal of pain. It ain't lifting your foot or your finger. It is just look. Well, a man needn't go to college to learn to look. You may be the biggest fool, and yet you can look. A man needn't be worth $1,000 a year to look. Anyway, anyone can look. Even a child can look. But then the text says, look unto me. Ah, he said in a broad Essex, many on you are looking to yourselves, but it's no use looking there. You'll never find any comfort in yourselves. Some say, look to God the Father. No, look to Him. By and by, Jesus Christ says, look unto me. Some on you say, we must wait for the Spirit's working. You have no business with that just now. Look to Christ. The text says, look unto me. Then the good man followed up his text in this way. Look unto me. I'm sweating. Great drops of blood. Look unto me, I am hanging on the cross. Look unto me, I am dead and buried. Look unto me, I rise again. Look unto me, I ascend to heaven. Look unto me, I am sitting at the Father's right hand. Oh, poor sinner, look unto me. Look unto me. When he had managed to spin out about 10 minutes or so, he was at the end of his tether. Then he looked at me under the gallery, and I dare say, with so few present, he knew me to be a stranger. Just fixing his eyes on me, as if he knew all my heart, he said, young man, you look very miserable. Well, I did, but I had not been accustomed to have remarks made from the pulpit on my personal experience before. However, it was a good blow struck right home. He continued, and you will always be miserable, miserable in life and miserable in death, if you don't obey my text. But if you obey now, this moment, you will be saved. Then lifting up his hands, he shouted, as only a primitive Methodist could do, young man, look to Jesus Christ. Look, look, look. You have nothing to do but look and live. I saw at once the way of salvation. I know not what else he said. I did not take much notice of it. I was so possessed with that one thought. I had been waiting to do 50 things. But when I heard that word, look, what a charming word it seemed to be. Oh, I looked until I could almost have looked my eyes away. There and then, the cloud was gone. The darkness had rolled away. And that moment I saw the sun, and I could have risen that instant and sung with the most enthusiastic of them of the precious blood of Christ and the simple faith which looks alone to Him. Oh, that somebody had told me this before. Trust Christ and you shall be saved. Yes, it was, no doubt, all wisely ordered. And now I can say, ever since by faith I saw the stream, thy flowing wound supply, redeeming love has been my theme, and shall be till I die. That happy day when I found the Savior and learned to cling to his dear feet was a day never to be forgotten by me. I listened to the word of God, and that precious text led me to the cross of Christ. I can testify that the joy of that day was utterly indescribable. I could have leaped, I could have danced. There was no expression, however fanatical, which would have been out of keeping with the joy of that hour. Many days of Christian experience have passed since then, but there has never been one which has had the fullest exhilaration, the sparkling delight which that first day had. I thought I could have sprung from the seat in which I sat and have called out with the wildest of those Methodist brethren, I am forgiven, I am forgiven, a monument of grace, a sinner saved by blood. My spirit saw its chains broken to pieces. I felt that I was an emancipated soul, an heir of heaven, a forgiven one, accepted in Jesus Christ, plucked out of the miry clay and out of the horrible pit, and with my feet set upon a rock and my goings established. Between 10:30 when I entered that chapel and 12:30 when I was back again at home, what a change had taken place in me. Simply by looking to Jesus, I had been delivered from despair, and I was brought into such a joyous state of mind, that when they saw me at home, they said to me, "Something wonderful has happened to you." And I was eager to tell them all about it. Oh, there was joy in the household that day when all heard that the eldest son had found the Savior and knew himself to be forgiven.